our last speaker for this session, a short talk, is Atul Butte. And maybe on your programs, it says that Atul is a division chief in systems medicine at Stanford. But as of two days ago, Atul moved on to head a new institute at UCSF, Computational Health Sciences Institute. And so Atul has been a great colleague here and is going to continue to be a great collaborator and great colleague in the future. But he's been really a leader in big data. I was sharing and doing analysis of big data, including data in the public domain. And I think today he's going to tell us about what he's been doing in the past few years at Stanford and what his work is continuing to be at UCSF. So Atul, welcome.
Great. Thanks for having me here today. And I see a lot of friends in the audience, and I'll still have friends here, even though my logos have changed here. So I'm a medical doctor speaking to all of you. So as you know, I have to start with my disclosure slide. And as you can see, I've started a bunch of companies. I consult for a bunch of companies. And you shouldn't believe another word I say in the next 10 minutes. But in all seriousness, I'm most proud of the bottom right of this slide, which are all the companies started by my students. And more than half my graduate students now start companies. And I'm particularly proud because this is the way I'm going to tell you over the next 10 minutes how I think academia is going to have to change and how innovation is going to have to change, especially in the space of precision medicine. I try to convince my students, and hopefully I'll convince you, that if you want to change the world today in academia, you can't just keep writing papers about it. You have to take it out of your lab and actually do something with it. And maybe I'll convince you. So I'm particularly proud. For many people, this is a slide of shame. For me, this is a slide of significance. This is how we're going to actually change the world, not just keeping writing papers. So you've heard from all the other speakers this morning that we're in this amazing era of precision medicine or personalized medicine. To me, I got my start about 15 years ago with this kind of neat device on the left there. On the left, you see what's called an affymetrix gene chip. This one little chip lets you sample or measure every gene in the genome, quantitates it. You can even use it to tell the spelling of the genes. And to me, it looks amazing. This company, Affymetrix, is down by Santa Clara, so it kind of looks like an Intel chip because Intel is a neighbor in Santa Clara. And it's the size of your thumbnail. Now, if you've never seen one of these, I always bring a prop with me, and you can see I have one in my hand here. And you could just see how tiny this is, but how amazingly cool this is. You should see this. Data, abstract data, actually comes from devices like this, which is pretty neat. When you get tired of measuring them one by one, you can measure them in a 96-well plate. That's what you see on the right there, 96 of them, all one well, one chip at a time. But the most amazing part of these chips today, right, it's just representative of all the data we're getting in biomedicine. You heard about sequencers, you heard this company Illumina, you've heard Affymetrix, many of these companies in space, whether it's the DNA spelling or the amount or the proteins, we have all these measurement abilities, these tools that let us make a lot of measurements on cells, on tissue. But actually, that's not even the most amazing part. The most amazing part of all this technology is somehow, magically, we get scientists to share this data with each other on the internet. It's not perfect, but because of mandates, starting with the journals and then the funding agencies and now with the government, we get scientists to share this data with each other and the rest of the world on the internet. So this started when I got my start 15 years ago. We were playing with the first 60 of these chips. They were precious. Today, if you go to the internet, you can get more than a million of these chips publicly available today. Actually, today it's 1.7 million of these samples already digitized, already available. Now, of course, it's available to all the scientists in this audience here, but it's even available to even the high school kids that need to do a science fair project. Any high school child can type in breast cancer at these websites and download almost 50,000 samples of breast cancer for a science fair project. What an amazing world this is in. You could see the exponential growth there, starting from zero in the early 2000s up to crossing a million as of 2012. If it looks like it's kind of slowing down there, it's because they only counted half that year, because actually this came out in the middle of 2012. We hit this threshold. Still growing. In just the morning session so far today, we've added probably about 500 new samples just today. Just today. Just sitting there, waiting for you, waiting for us to do something with this data. The scientists wrote a paper about it. Here's the data. They're on to collecting more data. The data's just sitting there waiting for you. So one of the first uses of this data, what we realized in the lab, well, let's use this to try to figure out new drugs, because you've heard about the problem in precision medicine. One of the biggest problems in precision medicine isn't going to be the diagnostic side. It's going to be, what do we do with all these diseases? Because our ability to develop drugs is much slower. You heard from Ricardo how long it takes. You heard from Ewan how expensive the process is, right, to come up with a new cystic fibrosis drug, for example. In fact, it's unbelievably expensive to come up with a new drug. This is an article that came out of Forbes. A lot of people cite this one in 2012. Everyone usually thinks it costs about $1 billion in 10 years to develop a drug. Actually, it's really simple math. Just take pharmaceutical research and development dollars, divide by the number of drugs, and then you realize it costs between $4 billion and $12 billion to come up with a new drug. Kind of not sustainable. And why is this number getting higher is because the numerator in that story is growing and we're still not getting as many drugs. I know we had a record number of filings last year, but we still have a record amount of unmet needs still that needs to be addressed. I kind of find this slide funny. They say the one in the middle there, Pfizer, at $7 billion, it's trying to actually merge with the one at the top, AstraZeneca, $12 billion. I'm not a business strategist, but if I were in the middle, I'd probably want to merge with the one below me, not the one that costs more than me to develop a drug. I'm not sure, but it's all about pipelines and things like that. So one of the things we realized in the lab is maybe we can use all this data that's out there, data on diseases, data on drugs, and actually try to put these two together to try to come up with stories for new drugs. Forget about new drugs. How about new uses for drugs, drugs that are already in use, but maybe there's a new use that's just hiding there, hiding in that data. And so in collaboration with Julian Saj and Nadine Janchan and his lab, Joel Dudley, in my lab, Joel Neal, who actually ran a clinical trial, this is one of our favorite stories, my favorite story, finding new uses for drugs using pure data, just using data that's available on the internet, figured out this story that an antidepressant, imipramine, that's a tricyclic antidepressant, we don't even use it anymore in the pharmacy, could actually have efficacy on small cell lung cancer. Now, small cell lung cancer is not a great cancer to have. 5% survival rate in 5 years. And here they have this special mouse. You knock out these three genes that are listed there, and you can kind of see the nodules in the top left, and this mouse gets its own lung cancer. This isn't a nude mouse where you put in human cancer. This mouse gets its own lung cancer. It takes weeks for that to happen. And on the right, you can see these nodules are gone, treated with imipramine. Now, we don't use imipramine anymore. We have better antidepressants, right? We have serotonin reuptake inhibitors because imipramine has some annoying side effects. It can make some people sleepy, and in some people, it can lead to an arrhythmia, can widen some of the arrhythmia, the spikes on your EKG. Actually, neither of those two side effects sound as bad as having lung cancer, which is a 5% survival rate in 5 years, and the cancer has melted away. It's gone. And this is just one example of a story where I think there are many uses of drugs out there, and the data is going to help us find them. Why I'm excited about this one is this one went from public data, computation, in 15 months, launch a clinical trial on this. Patients at Stanford tried on this. Now, it may or may not work. It's actually harder to get to the higher dose than we thought. This is what Joel Neal figured out, because that side effect of being sleepy actually is a big deal, right? If you've been told you only have 6 months to live, you don't want to spend those 6 months sleeping, actually. So we still have that same side effect problem that even new drug discovery folks have. So we've got to be more creative here. And this is Silicon Valley. So what do you do is you start a company around this, right? And I want to make a point about this, right? Here's an example of a company. I'm proud of this one because my wife runs it, called Numedi. Raised $3.5 million on the story. So you start with the unmet need. The data's available. You get NIH grants. You get the methods. You file the patents. You get the intellectual property. You spin out to a company, $3.5 million. Now, here's an important point. I'm not showing you $3.5 million to brag about it. I'm showing you $3.5 million because this is the new way science is going to continue in academia. You get the papers to work, you get the intellectual property, and you continue the science in a startup company. Do you know how hard it is to get a new $3.5 million NIH grant today, right? The ones that are laughing know how hard that is. At a certain point, there's so much de-risked here that outside private investors can keep the science going in a company. And that's the point here. Turns out drug companies even already want these drugs. Forget about the animal model data. They want it even at the computational prediction because there's so few drugs in the pipelines moving forward. We can do this for diagnostics as well. It's my particular favorite story is preeclampsia, a very annoying disease. It kind of fits in between two fields of medicine, obstetrics and pediatrics. Most people in the United States have never heard of eclampsia or preeclampsia unless, of course, you watch Downton Abbey, one of the characters dies from eclampsia. Spoiler alert, I'm sorry about that if you haven't watched this show. Otherwise, you've never heard of this disorder. This is a high blood pressure during pregnancy. It's still a reason why husbands lose wives around the world. And you can see the costs, maternal deaths. You can see $20 billion in direct costs in the U.S. annually. We didn't have a drug test. We didn't have a test for this at all. There's drugs actually in development right now, but we don't have a diagnostic for this. So Linda Liu and a grad student in my lab working with Bruce Ling and then Matt Cooper worked together to continue the story going. And here you could just see, if you do a search for preeclampsia, preterm birth, you could see 266 experiments. Someone around the world studied preterm birth or preeclampsia. Just data's just sitting there. Pick and choose the ones you want, put them together. Can imagine, see what's in common and chase those down as diagnostics. And here you can see an example of a blood test. It's one called hemopexin. You discovered it from the data. Take it from the RNA side to the protein side, and you can see it's elevated in mothers that are going to have preeclampsia. Now I'm showing you a company logo here again, right? Because at a certain point, you get the papers out. You don't want this to die in a publication. You need this to keep going. And so again, I'm going to show you another arrow. You start with the unmet need. The data's available. You get March of Dimes Center of Funding internally here, a great center that we have here at Stanford. You analyze the data, you get internal seed grants, and you spin that out. And $2 million in seed funding last summer. Again, how hard is it to get a $2 million grant to pursue this? Well, the science continues in a clinical trial outside of Stanford, outside of UCSF, in a private company. It may not work, but it's de-risking it with private investors now. And that's the point here. It shouldn't be taboo to talk about companies in places like this. We should be proud of this because it keeps the discoveries moving forward. Now, I'm a big fan of the next big open data, and just in a moment, I'll tell you, I'm investing half of my lab in the next big open data. Everyone around has mentioned clinical trials. To be honest with you, what is a clinical trial? It's the most expensive experiment in the world. Half of them fail, and it's the reason why these drugs are costing billions. You know what? We have this weird culture when the trial fails, we don't even write a paper about it. It's got to change. We've got to get the data out. The Europeans are requiring it. The US will get there eventually. It starts with the journals. It gets to the funding agencies eventually. So IMPORT is one website that I run where we release 100 raw clinical trials that you can just go and download today. And the data just keeps coming, whether it's electronic medical record data, side effect data, molecular data, clinical data. It's all there sitting, waiting for you, waiting for the next generation of trainee to actually come up with that discovery. So in the end, I'm just going to close. I've had a great 10 years here at Stanford, a lot of friends that I'll continue, and I'm moving to head something called the Institute for Computational Health Sciences. We're right next door to Benioff Children's Hospital and Illumina. We're going to be a brand new building in 2019 in Mission Bay. And why would I leave Stanford for UCSF? It turns out UCSF is one of 5 UC medical schools. There's Davis, Irvine, Los Angeles, San Diego, and San Francisco. And I get to help build out the common data repository to study all of those patients. 13 million patients seen at a UC hospital. I'm going to put all that together. And that, to me, is the ultimate big data, is population-level data, whether kids or adults. This is the new challenge that my lab and I will be facing after a great 10 years here at Stanford. And with that, thank you very much.